They're coming on straight to move and going, look at all the fuckers.
The trouble is you can't get across the road.
Turn around. Thank you. Getting food taken?
Yeah, I think that's ours.
Smithy,
taken today.
Right, is everybody finished? Listen. If you're finished, what I want you to do is think about the start of the week. Do you feel you've made a good start? Do you feel you've made a medium start? You assess yourself, and then what I want you to do is I want you to put down a name of what you're going to do for the rest of the week, what you're hoping to do in the next few days. So if you feel you've been late everywhere, one of your aims for the rest of the week could be you're going to be on time.
Oh, dear.
We know how she could type, although she would be.
Hello, Helen.
Yeah, he'll do it.
Well, sir, what?
And another birdie. Oh, they're definitely performing for the camera.
Thank you. 16:14,
get off soon. Yes, that's it. 16:15.
Cross in, hurry! Larry!
To the Solway Firth in the west, some 73 miles. In places 10 feet thick and perhaps 21 feet high to the top of the parapet, the wall was certainly a massive physical barrier, rather like the Berlin Wall, but that was only part of the scheme. To the north, there were already existing Roman roads and some forts. Immediately in front of the wall, there was a deep ditch. On the line of the barrier, there were regularly spaced observation turrets, mile castles, and forts. To the south, there were more roads, and a great southern barrier which we call the Vallum, another deep ditch with symmetrical ramparts, perhaps designed to prevent unauthorized access to the military zone and, of course, its valuable military stores. To the west, down the Cumbrian coast, the fortifications continued for a further 35 miles, although without the wall itself, craftsmen and priests. As the years went by, more often often than not, the new recruit to the war garrison was likely to be drawn from those villages, with son following father into a well-paid and secure job. Bits and pieces of the old Roman frontier can be seen almost throughout its length and breadth, from the major port of South Shields to the dreamy little village of Bowness-on-Solway, or from the hills above Penrith to the bleak moors which encircle Bewcastle. But the finest remains, in the most dramatic of settings, lie in the central sector of the frontier, between modern Chollerford on the River North Tyne and the village of Banks above Lanercost. Let us take a look at those remains, working our way from west to east. This stretch of wall near Banks is the first good indication of what lies ahead, a favourite section with some visitors who can study the thing from the safety of their car or bus seats. Dangerous river. Access to the remains is somewhat tedious from the south bank of the river, but the masonry is as good as anything the Romans built in the north, and it reminds us that Roman military architects took major river crossings in their stride. This short program has shown you just some of the outstanding remains in the central sector of the wall, but there is much to see elsewhere, both to east and west, and to north and south, because the frontier was not just a wafer-thin line on the ground, but rather a broad area of military control. Because the most energetic efforts of later mankind and industry have failed to remove entirely all traces of those Roman builders. What we have seen of the remains represents but a small breakdown of law and order. Looting, the ravages of the weather, and the growth of nature's plant life took their toll, leaving the once mighty Roman frontier an easy target for the stone robbers. It is now the interests of the public which finances modern archaeological research, and our understanding of the Roman past becomes clearer every year. We hope you enjoy your visit.
Coming down the run, you may or may not have noticed the soldier standing by the ox cart. But when you go back through there, have a look at his helmet. It is much larger than this. Certainly much more decoration to it. I like the willing volunteer. We just come along here to stand on the deck with this one. Don't you look at me in that sort of voice, young man. You volunteers, you're going into this, and they'll learn you not to volunteer for anything in future. Now, this armor was known as the segmentator, segments. It had made a plate of iron, you see? When I open this armor up, you see the plates are simply riveted to a leather under harness. It comes apart in two equal halves. The back looks the same as the front. Normally what the man would do, he'd lace it up the back, get it on his shoulders, fasten it up the front, be his hand ready. We do these way. Pop your arms straight through there. How's it feel? It feels okay, does it? Made a good injury, this one. Solid plate, but it weighed much lighter than the chain mail. Only about 30 pounds it weighed this. Now properly laced up, and gave this man good protection around the body. It is impossible that I ever saw him with a dagger underneath those plates. Apart from the little lack of weight, young man, it also had this advantage to you. Had you been wearing that heavy chain mail, every time he raised his sword or spear arm, he was dragging all of that heavy weight of mail with him. That's it, you put it in one. You left him three or four small plates. At the end of the day, that sword was much easier and stronger than your auxiliary counterpart there. Now listen, the reason why I pull your sweater up like that is just to increase the weight a little. There you are. 75 pounds of weight, right? And I believe you're walking up on the wall there, aren't you? You'd probably be walking about 2.5 miles at most. There's a wall wall behind me. The bottom two lines on that one read that a horse march of 25 miles per day was out and out. Wearing and carrying all of this. I'll use the thing was part of that. Right, here's how it is. You keep it on if you like. It's not too bad. And you just stay here. Don't worry, I can come back to you. And a possible combination of both. A man's hands tend to get sweaty. Leather is absorbent. Soaked up the sweat and they gave this man a better grip on his shield. The shields are etched in bronze to strengthen the edge of the shield. Now this part here, it's known as the center part. This then, the large flat old shield of the auxiliary soldier. Militaire. And that is spelled C-I-N-G-U-L-U-M. That's a kingdom part of it. Militaire, M-I-L-I-T-A-R-E. The kingular militaire, or simply the military belt. These plates on the waistband here are enamel plates riveted to the leather. Coming to the dagger itself, the sheath for this one beautifully decorated again with all this enamel work. Up top, the heavy gold mounted hilt, the precious and the semi-precious stone set in there. But don't run away with the idea that these belts are just pretty things to look at. They were also very practical. I said the other dagger was straight bladed. When I draw this, it has this type of blade to it. It is known as a fluted blade, and it tapers down to a long, fine, needle-like point. And this one in the hand of an knife man, I would rate very high indeed. The commando dagger? Possibly. The dagger of the assassin? Certainly. And I say that for this reason. Take it off the belt. Into the bronze rings with the loop of leather, you see? Just slip that leather loop up on your shoulder. Your dagger is there. Put your rope to your toe rod over the top of that thing. Think it would. And you keep a nice firm grip on it there. Thank you a bit. Now, young man, you've been in the body armor, right? When you're wearing your military belt, the vertical belt came down below your main body armor, they're pretty strategically placed. What's your name? you been about? Not really. The next few moments are going to be. I'll call you Marcus. An old-fashioned Roman name, Marcus. Take a look at it. Not a pretty lass here now. Took your Roman fighting man, this one. Only Marcus. Of course you are. True, Marcus. The troubles are just about to begin all over again, you see. You come here looking against another barbarian this week.
conduit back in here underneath the dam comes over to the bottom of the valve tower. Again, you probably made it.
same sort of, instead of a wheel turning the water, instead of the road turning the wheel around the water. Right then, so right, you know what I said? When the lake gets full, it spills over the wall up at the top there and runs down the channel. Now this is the spillway channel here. The water comes flying down there, the stone base here. And over the weir and off down the river. Then normally the water would in there we can put it to the turbine.
Thank you. Tiffany, get on!
Thank you.
Come on, man, my name is Mr. Dick. I say, come on, let me lead you. He's a dick. He's stupid, too. Record him. Fall over, Flanny. He's filming you, Glenn. He's trying to get out of the camera.
Hello, what's he talking
about? I am so cool. I'm the best one here on video.
This is Paul Flanagan for the 6 o'clock news. At
Bye. smile on the back. Hello. I'd love to know some special names this week. We're going to get regular to you.
What's that?
Days at the end. If you've done Wednesdays.
You're not supposed to be enjoying this.
This is to impress.
Have they?
Don't make his nose bleed, Mrs. Chidley. Misery personified. Sports. And yes, they did when we originally added up all the points. But there's been an objection to the winner. Yes, I'm sorry, Mrs. Chidley. And there's been a steward's inquiry. And unfortunately, the steward's inquiry was rejected, so we decided Group 5 could still have their prize. So Group 5 girls, please come forward and collect your prize. The treasure trail was nailed, wasn't it? Otterburn Hall were the cheeseburgerettes, so if you come forward, you're... Well done, girl. Make sure that their bedrooms were kept neat and tidy in time for the teacher coming. coming into church. So that the bedroom chosen by each member of staff is in fact, we go from one bedroom, which we all thought, well, really, there's only one person in. But I find that one person can be just as untidy as six people. So, Georgia, come and get your prize. You know who must have the prize now, because some of you know what state you left your rooms in tonight. So, Paula, Luke and Julie Moore. Very good. These two girls kept the cleanest rooms, but they were also the quietest. I didn't think anything. Mr. Turnbull tells me, and he went on a raiding party to find this out as well, that the three boys, Christopher Webber, David Heron, and Neil Dixon, were the people who looked after their room. So you can call the boys. Actually learnt something whilst you've been away from me. So things like that are a nice part. And really, you only learn about these things if you're prepared to do a bit of work on them. Now, I know a lot of you think it's awful to have to spend a whole hour, but really, an hour out of the whole day tying together what you've been looking at, going back over it in your mind, and it will stay with you probably longer. You'll remember what you saw in Crags Eye Hall. So, the best prizes, the most expensive prizes, boys, because in the teacher's eyes, obviously we think that this is important, go to the people whose work for the week deserves some merit. So, in reverse order, for a change, is Regan Patterson. Group three. Again, of course, there had to be lots of soul searching before any decision was taken, because there were so many to choose from, because we'd had such a good teacher for the full week. Mr. Patel. After at least with David Ogden. As usual, took this very seriously because he believes in good work, and he said that there was only one person in his group who was worthy of a prize, and that was David Heron. Like pain of the week, portal of the week, big head of the week. I'm not going to tell you who they are because everybody knows anyway. But I will tell you. Sorry, you're in here. So the person in group one whose work merited an award is Carl Wandel. No way, we're going to go up there and see you running around daft. We want you in bed, lights out by 11 o'clock. You've got a long bus journey, and I know, again, that was a comment made by lots of you, that you found the travelling tiring, but tomorrow you will find the travelling tiring. So get some sleep. Lights out by 11. In the morning, if you're up early enough and you have some spare time before you come down to breakfast, then by all means do a bit packing. But what will happen is, lock your doors after you come down for your breakfast, before you come down for your breakfast. Come down, have your breakfast. Keep your keys this time, don't return them to the staff, but make sure that your room is locked.
Never believe it.
Four rounds in, all together, girls.
Why is that two and three?
Oh, don't say that. Every time I go past Dambrosie. Can I put my fingers down? I'm feeling well. Yes, in a minute. We'll just stop it in a minute. Joyce, you haven't even been to the toilet yet, have you?
No, I'm thinking about this. Have I got time?
Because we're on the tape, is it? Is it on the schedule?
Do you want 25 or 30 seconds?
Starting from now.
There you go.
We started.
No, I haven't started.
Don't worry.
The next time I make sure I've got something organised.
Yeah, right. Yes. Good. I mean,
I'll get a worksheet done on Bolham Lake.
You do that. You do that.
Oh, no, anything but a worksheet.
It wouldn't be a particular...
Fuchsias, that's right. Oh, you have to smile. Pardon?
Yeah. steps in the trunk.
Yeah.